council meeting order, September 20, 2016. Tom, you have blessing for us this morning, this afternoon or tonight or whatever.
Let's pray. Lord, thanks for the community of St. John. Thank you to those that give up their time to help with the business of St. John. Thanks for those that are filling in various capacities. Lead and guide this group tonight. Those that are in attendance, give direction and your wisdom. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Any additions to the agenda? None? Any citizen comments? None? Okay. Move the minutes of regular council meetings, September 6, 2016. Appropriation ordinance, 2009-9216, $48,031.88. Ordinance 920 of 2016 for $32,295.91. And approved Mansell construction invoice for repairs of inlet and the gutter at 5th and West Street. Original quote is $2,000. Actual cost is $3,100.
So moved. What was the actual, why was that so much higher?
I don't know. Corey, that was one of the last deals that Corey did. I know they had quite a bit more work over there in the bottom of that, down where the storm drain comes out of it. It was broken down pretty hard, and there was a big hole underneath there. It took quite a little bit more time to repair and patch it up before they formed it. But that's the only thing I know the administration found. Other than that, I can't really tell.
Is there a motion to approve, and we've got a second. Any more discussion? All in favor? All opposed? 5-0. Department head and committee reports. Grocery store task force. Tony.
Today we had a really good meeting with, Tony.
Tony Borcher,
yes. He actually is kind of a finance thing for Save-A-Lot. Had a lot of good information for us. I want to talk a little bit, though, about when Jordan was here, he talked about us maybe getting a feasibility study, and so he actually sent, this is just a copy of what he sent to Carolyn. Actually, Carolyn got in touch with this guy. He's an independent. We kind of feel like, Carolyn and I feel like this might be something that the city and the economic development could do together. The total cost is up here at the top. If you look, I think it's $6,900. And I think, Carolyn, they're going to kind of come in and they're going to do a study. They're going to see about, like, population, how many people work out of town, you know, and things like that to see what, if where, and where a grocery store might be best suited in this town. I know that we talked with Tony today, and I know, like Save-A-Lot, they will do their own feasibility study. Jordan said they probably would too.
Jordan?
Yeah.
This is who Jordan.
He recommended, I know, but I didn't know if he would use this or if they would
this
do
is
another.
Who they've used in other stores.
Okay. So he would use this feasibility study.
Okay.
So. They would be looking at the old Dillon's building, and they also would be looking at another possible place in town, correct?
I think that a lot of this is focusing on the draw that a store here can have in terms of the amount of business. So that's kind of a critical factor in your break-even analysis. And then I think that leads to some of the analysis of whether this store, with the layout that it has, the amount of space it has, and the amount of merchandise that can be sold on a floor of that square footage, if you can find your break even with that facility. So, you know, how break even works with a store that's 3,800 square feet roughly of retail space versus a new format that we probably have in a lot of cases for a town the size, probably
10,000 square feet.
I know so that, but you know, he will focus, I think, a lot on the competitor analysis too. So, you know, looking at the stores that people most frequent in, when they don't shop here. I'm sorry.
No, that's all right. I want you to explain it because you are the ones that visited with him. So,
kind of adding to that kind of analysis too, we're initiating some things that he said, even if it's not scientific, it can be helpful to him in kind of looking where to focus most in his competitor analysis. So we're doing a base economic development, kind of deployed a survey that he provided a lot of questions for that asks people, you know, of these stores, what's your primary store currently? What's your secondary store? Why do you shop there? People take the time to do it. It's got like 70 questions, but we've had, we just put it out there Tuesday or something like that.
Where's that at? Because I haven't seen that.
We put it on Facebook. We're putting it, if the paper will print it, we'll put it in the St. John News. We'll put it wherever we
can. Is that something that we could add to a utility bill, maybe mailing? Is that?
Well, link-wise, it's not going to fit.
It's not going to fit.
On a
okay.
utility bill, but we can give them where they
could get it.
Could get it. Or if we're able to put it in a, I don't know. I mean, I suppose if we wanted to put this utility bill in an envelope that allowed for a survey of 70 questions or something, you know, there's those kinds of
Carolyn,
possibilities. But
is this something that can be done online?
Yes. In fact, it is a SurveyMonkey setup.
Okay.
But by putting it in the newspaper, I guess we're hoping to get a few people that aren't
online.
We can at least get a little flyer in the utility bill to people who do have internet capabilities that they can go online and take care of it. So that would be something.
I think. Carolyn said that she's going to meet with your board, correct, about the funding for this. I would like to ask you guys to maybe help with that. If you think it's something that I think it could benefit us as a community as far as looking at anything else also. I mean, I think, now the dates are wrong. You said he wouldn't be able to start until the third week in October, correct?
Right.
So
I think he sent the email, basically said, if you'll commit today, I'll come out in 2 days and do the survey. Well, that was a little impractical when you need the, you know, approval of boards. We're not an individual that can just contract somebody on the spot. So in lieu of that, then he has another client in line, basically for the next 3 or 4 weeks.
So it would be probably November before we would know anything, which is quite a ways away yet.
Where's the alternate property yet?
I don't know. I did not discuss that with him. I don't know if there is really an alternate property yet. I mean, specific.
I think in the context of St. John, it's not as if our traffic patterns are going to vary any other location significantly. You know, it's not like we have a main street that you would need to consider the traffic patterns of that versus across town 2 miles away or something, and the way it would be in a more urban context. I think the comparison is a store of this size versus a store of
a new building. Which would
and the thing is we don't have a place ready to go. That is a barrier. I mean, if your analysis suggests that the best long-term solution for the town is a new location, there isn't one. So it'll take, you know, a lot of our discussions have been around the idea of even, does it make sense to get going in this building? Because we know that a different location is going to take some time. Can you make this one work for the long term? Maybe that's a scenario. or are we kind of spending good money after bad? That's one of the things that comes up in discussion. The real question is, can you get the volume of sales that you need to be successful in the long term in the facility that's, you know, it's not the way you build it if you build it from scratch. And I think, you know, at least from my perspective, at least what I'm fearful of is getting something going that isn't really set up for success for the long term, and then we're right back into the scenario 2 or 3 years from now. So, and I feel like that would be an even worse situation than we are now, because it'd be even harder to get the second person to set up shop after someone struggles. So that's the nature of some of the discussions we've had, and maybe what this feasibility study could put some data toward.
So they're looking to start, you said, the third week of October, so that would be October 17th,
somewhere
around that line. Mm-hmm.
October 17th. And so that puts our report clear into November.
Right.
And while you think on that, I'm going to go ahead and tell you that Rick Weigel from La Crosse is one of our independents that was here. He is ready to put a store in. He did call me last week, and he told me that if he couldn't have an answer by this past Monday, that he was pulling out. I told him that I could not and would not do that. So that if he needed his answer by Monday, I guess his answer was no. So I do believe he did tell me he was going to call Marshall, and I'm assuming he did.
He told me the same thing, and I told him, I said, I could let him know tomorrow, but he wanted us to guarantee him the building tomorrow.
I explained to him that we as a task force wanted to visit with all of our options, and that that would not take place until this week sometime, and that we would... Only after that would we be giving our report to you guys. So I felt like that I was not going to tell him yes, and if he had to have an answer, then the answer would be no. He doesn't necessarily have all of his funding, but he is ready to come in. I'm not sure we as a task force are ready to say that's who we want. I'm not sure he's the best fit for our community.
I don't think we should commit to anything right now until we've actually...
I agree with that.
...done some more due diligence on this.
I
agree with what the task force is recommending, and that's let's talk with everyone. Let's get everything going. So, yes.
Okay.
That's my thoughts. I don't want the rest of you.
I feel about the same way.
You
guys went through everything.
This I'm not sure about. I mean, this sounds like something we should have done before we've already invested the money we've invested. So,
I mean, if we're going to do this, and you said that the two other ones said that they would do their own.
Well, now I think she said this is the same person that White's Food Liner would use. So
they would use the same report.
So, and this is why I think it's important for the city to kind of be a part of contracting this, because we want, I mean, ultimately, the city's the one that's going to have to be in a position to take action on this issue in general. And we want you to, I think, have confidence that this is worth doing, and that when we have information from that, it's something you feel comfortable, you know, using in your decision. So. If you know, we continue to have more discussions with White's Food Liner, you know, this is something that a contractor that they have used before, so it is kind of coming from that direction. As far as Save-A-Lot, they're going to do their internal analysis, but this may be what, I mean, I kind of liken this to the city of Lakin that was trying to get a hotel for a long period of time, and they ended up doing this type of feasibility analysis. In the end, I think it was Best Western is the chain that they got interested, but Best Western wouldn't have even talked to them if they hadn't kind of, through this feasibility study, kind of shown the way it could work. Now, in the end, they had to kind of do their own, you know, they have their own methodology that they use within that corporation. I think the same is the case for Save-A-Lot. But he kind of explained today that the hardest part in their case, where they're a licensee for this corporation, is getting the corporation to agree to putting their brand in this market. So he kind of explained that in their case, we probably wouldn't want to just go to Save-A-Lot Corporation and ask them to do an initial study, because they're going to go right off the hand and go, nope, too small a market, we're not interested. But if we can show a scenario where the break even is at a lower price, so because the city has got some involvement in providing the building or whatever that case is, you know, that if we can show a scenario where the break even is at a lower level of sales than what they might see in another market, and this feasibility study might be part of kind of that hook, that might be what it takes to get them interested and take the next steps with them. Right now, kind of the way we left the meeting today is that their finance director and real estate director and I are going to try working on some break-even scenarios, and we'll see if we can kind of take the next step from there.
I did a little figuring. He was saying about what a 10,000 square foot building would cost, and just from taking figures offline, and I'm not sure about building costs here, but you're looking at about $2 million to get a new building in here. And I don't know if if you can get a grocery store that's going to spend that kind of money to come in and say, yeah, I can recover my funds, if that's something
that
you know.
That all your utility, all your HVAC and inventory.
Not inventory. That would just be coolers, shelving, and the building. Inventory would be on top of that. Now, that might be a little bit high, but...
But ballpark estimates
ballpark.
For this building might be in that ballpark of $750,000.
Right.
So there's, broadly speaking, some of the compare and contrast. Are you better off with 3 times the amount of square footage for sales to offset
the higher
cost, no doubt? I don't know how much to get into some of this stuff tonight, but some of the things like with the Save-A-Lot Corporation, they're involved in affordable housing and some of the other markets where they're doing work, and have gotten themselves eligible for federal tax credits.
Right.
But those kinds of things are not practical for a smaller scale project. You almost have to go that next level of a bigger project to get some of those major federal tax credits involved.
So I don't know, but that's kind of where we're at. According to everybody, at least with Quite's Foodliner and Save-A-Lot, they both said, you know, the size of the store, because if you don't carry, you know, the variety, people then want to go out of town to get, and then they buy everything. So that, you know, we all know that. The only thing is, this is available and could be done much quicker. The new store is going to take, I don't know, a year, year and a half, I don't know. I don't know what, maybe 2 years, I don't know. So,
be happy with the numbers you get when your $7,000 feasibility study.
You mean you think it won't be in favor?
Yeah.
Yeah. I have wondered that too, and I think it would that work against us then? I don't know. I don't know.
Well, we've already bought the building. So.
I know you have.
I wanted to not use it, you know what I mean?
I know what you're saying. And I understand that. But I want to present all the facts to you so that you understand what we're...
It may not be an entirely a yes or no, you do a grocery store or don't do a grocery store. It may be an element of here's, you know, guidance on how to design it,
right.
You know, essentially.
Right.
Is the $2 million building that you're talking about, how much overlap is that in the $700,000?
That would be, well, I just
that
did.
That's the building?
That's the building, and I tried to look at fixtures, you know, but I am not a grocery store person, so I just kind of took like, kind of mentally counted up like what Walmart has for freezers and refrigerators, and I just kind of went that route. Bob, I'm not a grocery store person, so I am just surmising. He said, I believe 3.3 is what they spent for their 16,000 square foot building.
Which is a bigger facility.
All 3.3 million.
Yeah. I don't know if that was inventory. I don't remember whether he said that or not, but
I think there's, you know, one that, and it's getting a little bit, it's not right. Onega is probably a very good parallel to our town, and theirs was more in the $1.5 million range for a brand new store, all said and done, everything.
What was that figure?
One and a half, but it has been a few years at this point, so.
I just took a $45 square foot building, and it probably typically could be more like 55 or 65. But I took a 45 and just kind of figured that, and then I just went through and figured some shelving and stuff. So I just kind of wanted to be able to give you a ballpark figure of what, you know, I think I actually used 9,700 because he said 97 by 100 feet was their smallest model. So 9,700 square feet. And that's kind of just how, you know, I came up with that. But it could be way less and it could be way more.
When they do the study, don't they assume the purposes of the study that you want to put in a broker's store?
Yes.
It's not yes or no, it's what broker's store do I want.
Right.
And I think, you know, as an example, Pratt wants to build a new movie theater, so they did one of these studies. And it was kind of, what is it going to cost to put in a movie theater versus what we're going to make? So how big does that theater need? How many screens, how many people can expect versus how many people going outside here and that kind of thing. So the assumption started with, we want to put in a movie theater. And the study was, how big is that movie theater need to be for this size of town, for what people want to do and how often they want to go to that movie theater. I think that's kind of where this type of study starts. It's not necessarily, do we want or not want grocery stores, if the assumption is we're going to put in a grocery store, we need to know what that grocery store is going to look like. Mm-hmm. That's what this type of stuff should do.
My deal is on this study, it needs to say we're going to put in a grocery store, but it's going to go in that building.
I know there, I mean, that is part of it. I mean, I don't.
It's not whether we're going to build another building or not.
Right.
The customer base in Stafford County is overgrown so much. It doesn't make any difference whether you got a $3.3 million building or whether you got a $200,000 one. The feasibility is if you got a $200,000 deal with a certain amount of customer base in Stafford County, it's a whole lot easier to make the deal work with $200,000 for debt than it is $3.3 million. That's about all I got to say. And there's, unfortunately, you've only got about 5,000 customers in this community. You're not going to get them out of town to drive down here to this grocery store.
The issue isn't getting them out of town. The issue is getting those that are here to shop here.
You're right.
And it's that balance of how much do you have to keep them here versus shopping somewhere else. You know, having enough variety or whatever it is, you know, and that's part of what this study will look at is, are people shopping for quality, price, variety, you know, what are their triggers? And, you know, I don't know, when it's kind of like when you go to a bigger store, you end up spending more, you know, just because you probably find things that are appealing to you that you don't find in a smaller, they're not literally not there, you know? I mean, that's kind of part of the merchandising puzzle, I think, is what does the retailer need to do to get the level of sales, they need to pay the bills.
That's called marketing.
Well, I mean, some of the things that he talked through today, I mean, and again, I'm not saying that, there are reasons that this store, this building, could be a good choice. There's also things to consider that count against it. So things like, you know, they're all concerned about the idea of a dock. You know, you literally pay more for groceries coming in when you can't buy them by the pallet, or take them off the truck by the pallet. So, you know, you looked at it, the cost of labor to, you know, to employ the people, to store it upstairs, bring it downstairs, take it off the truck by hand, and that kind of stuff. It plays in, you know.
I think there are disadvantages over here, and we've discussed those before, and we all know that. But it is a building, it is halfway ready. I mean, you know.
So, yeah.
So
we're not gonna solve that issue tonight.
No,
the issue is really more the idea of, is the feasibility study something that you would find useful? That ultimately, do you find that you would value it, want to utilize it? I mean, economic development isn't the one that can take action on it. We contract for it, you know, we can offset the costs of it, but we want the city, you know, to have some ownership, I guess, of it.
It's not something you're
going
to look at and use. I mean, that's
something. What does the grocery store committee, what do they think about it?
Well, you know, I'm not...
The task force.
I'm not really sure about a feasibility study. I mean, I know we bought the building and that's what we wanted to do, and I don't know if this would change your mind, if this is going to help you in any way. You know, my concern is a new building is so costly. I know it can be costly to redo that one. I mean, you know, I ran some figures on that. Bob, you know, we've talked about that a little bit. And I think ultimately, in the end, the task force is going to give you a rundown on who we visited with and what they might need to come here. If this helps you decide who you want or where you want it, then I think it's a good thing. Is this strictly going to be just for grocery store?
Just for grocery store. So it's also, I mean, an element of what we can do to get some of our best candidates and beyond the, hey, we're willing to talk to you, get them to see that this could be a good investment of their time and effort.
If you're not going to look at it, then, you know, I don't know. I mean, if we're going to do whatever we can, we're going to put them over here regardless of what this says, then.
Still, the numbers that are garnered from all of this will give us a better idea, and it will give someone else a better idea who might want to come in here, whether it's going to be worth their time or not as well.
That is a possibility, yes.
But you're also dealing with people. I mean, a study like this, when you ask somebody today what if they want a store in here,
Exactly.
Right. That's a given.
And there's just too much subjectiveness to this, too. I mean, there's too many ideas that, people are going to say, I'm going to shop there. Well, it comes in, it's a little higher than somewhere else, so they're going.
I honestly think whether you do a race or a study over here, or if you do it with a brand new $3.5 million building, it's going to be the same.
Yep.
Just because the building's bigger and brand new don't mean that the break-even point isn't going to be twice as high.
Right. Yep.
And if you're not drawing them in from other places other than Stafford County, it isn't going to make a difference if you get a brand new building. I think it's kind of high to be spending to possibly end up shooting yourself in the foot. But I don't know.
Did you say that economic development would pay for part of that?
We have a board meeting tomorrow, so I should not say yes until they vote on it, but I have a recommendation for them to do so, and know that it can fit into a certain grant category that we have.
Can you let us know as soon as possible what it is that the economic development would like to put into it? Maybe we can make a decision next time on
how about you make a decision and then economic development could act tomorrow? Would that be a reasonable, I mean, if you say that we'll pay half or something, if you feel like that is the right amount, then
I think half would be fine. I mean, that way we wouldn't have to foot the whole bill. I don't know what the rest of you think. I think this is information that we could definitely use, regardless of whether we're going to stick over here or not. I say we should stick over here. We purchased the building. We need to utilize it.
I don't think we got a way to spend $3.3 million either, or $3.5 million.
Right.
I mean, I guess I'm not. I still think even spending $3,450 is still.
But already, if they decide to do that, if you've got somewhere we can get $3,450,
yep,
without robbing everybody in the world, yep, where would that be coming from?
We've been robbing Peter to pay Paul on a whole lot of stuff.
I haven't told you guys no yet, so I found it everywhere.
I just want it to be a study that you're going to use. I mean, because it's, if we decide next Tuesday we have the perfect grocery store and they're willing to come in, I mean.
If they're wanting to do one and they think it's valuable to them at that time too, it'd be something that maybe we could help with at that point. You know what I'm saying? If they're going to do one anyway.
We'll save a lot, Will.
Is your lacrosse gentleman?
That was Rick.
Right?
That's Rick.
Has he offered a 10-year deal?
I did not visit with him about that yet due to the fact that we had not discussed anything with City Council, so I have not offered him anything. I know that when he told me that his financing included coolers, point of sale system. So basically he would be providing all of the inside stuff other than the shelving.
So he
would
right?
Well, he has to get his financing, and the reason he wanted an answer was because he's going to have to do a small business loan, and it was going to cost him money, and I just told him I couldn't give him an answer, and I wouldn't because we had not met with anybody.
I do know that he also would like, one thing he told me was, the one time I let him in over there, was that he did want something that where in the future, 5, 7, 10 years down the road, he could purchase the whole building and everything. But I don't know if that's something we want to let happen or not. But he wanted all this up front. He kind of wanted us to decide on a price that at the end of that time he writes the city a check for that building, and it's his free and clear.
Right.
But it's determined from day one.
My only thing is I'm not very good at being given ultimatums when I told him it was a process to begin with, so.
I think the task force should explore all the avenues before they make a choice on what we're doing.
Right.
We need to get our facts. Together as a whole body, all the people involved, see what our resources are before we make a choice.
I agree. And we just aren't there yet. I mean, today was our meeting to say that we just weren't there yet.
With that being said, I think if the man is interested, he's going to be interested when we get our facts and figures together also. And the question, if he's not, what is
I see a lot of red flags.
I do too, I guess. That's why I said he would not probably be
saying
our...
anything bad about it.
No, and I don't really know.
We've got the task force in place
to
examine this and bring it to the city,
right,
and the economic development is on board. And so I suggest that to the task force, that's what I explore all my avenues before.
And that's what I explained to them, that we were going to explore them all as a task force.
Is the council, am I out of line, council?
No, I think they're right.
But
but White's is still interested.
Well, they said they'd take a look if everything was set up, yes. Actually, you know, I really liked Jordan's presentation.
Who is Jordan?
Jordan is from White's Food Liner. I felt like, so far, I feel like they could meet a need here. We are a bit smaller than what they like, and at first he said, you know, a different building, but then he said he wasn't so sure that this couldn't be utilized. I have sent him some stuff, and he is looking at it to give us figures as to maybe what it would cost to put in coolers and what kind of coolers we would need, shelving, and all that. So,
did you say that they were going to, White's Food Liner was going to be doing their own feasibility study?
Well, this is the guy that he would use, so he may possibly, I mean, I have not specifically asked Jordan if he would use our feasibility study if we paid for it, but this is where you got the name from. So I could sure ask him and see if he was, or if they're going to come in and do their own again. I don't know.
If they're going to do their own, I don't see the point of us spending right. that kind of money. But, I mean, if they're not going to do their own, which I really don't see that they wouldn't.
I believe any store like that, maybe not an individual, but any small chain store,
right.
they're going to do a feasibility study.
They're going to do it themselves, study. Right? So,
yes.
I don't see why we would need to spend.
Now he might use this feasibility study if we've done it.
Right.
Means this is who they use. And I could ask him that.
I think he has confidence in him. He's used it multiple
yes.
times.
Yes.
So.
I think he would.
I was going to say, I guess it doesn't matter if we do it and it's bad. They're going to do it anyway and find out the same thing we're going to find out.
I don't think they're going to say you shouldn't put in a grocery store.
I know that.
Could say how
but big. It could say that, you know, in order for this to work for somebody else, the city's going to have to give them the building and pay half the utilities.
Well, here's the thing. I think we need to know that stuff up front because, again, the last thing that we want is for somebody to come
right.
in here half prepared
right.
and be a mess in a year. And, again, you know, I mean, it happens. So I think the more we can do to try to, you know, really set things up the right way successfully in the first place, the better off the town's going to be.
I'll move the city pay $1,500 towards the feasibility study.
A motion on the table?
I'll second that.
Got a second on the table. Do you guys have any more discussion? Think about what you're doing there. I really think that in the corporate world, everybody does a feasibility study. And if you're going to try to target somebody like a bigger food chain, they're not going to throw it in the trash. They're probably going to use it. They may not look at it real good, real hard.
Well, we did specifically ask Tony today, and he said they would do their own.
But, again, we might not get them to get to that point if we don't have some data that shows
that's true.
How a store can work in this environment.
It's your choice. We've got a motion in a second, but I just thought I'll throw that out before we vote on it. I think we ought to explore all of our options. We need to get our facts and figures before we've got to have information. My opinion.
I understand that, but we've kind of already went one direction, you know what I mean?
We have, Troy, and you're right.
If we were going to do, I mean... And I agree, there probably ought to be one done, but the other deal is I don't want it to shoot us in the foot on what we've already spent money on.
I understand that.
I mean, to me, to me, when they do this feasibility study, if we agree to do it, they need to understand that that's the building we're going to use. We got the money invested. I mean, we're not going to go out and spend another $1 million anyway. So, I mean, what's the use of giving them the option of saying, well, maybe look at a different facility? Because we already got it. I mean, just this is a feasibility study with this building and the clientele that we have, instead of trying to look at, well, what if we build a $3.2 million building? Well, we're not going to. We ain't got to maybe do that anymore.
Well, yeah.
Why even look at it?
If someone in other business takes these figures and builds a $3 million building, that building would be put for sale.
There's other things that can be done with it.
Yeah, I understand that.
Yeah.
But I'm just saying the city ain't going to spend another $1 million.
But at this point in time, a $3.3 million building, if you build it out here, there's nobody at this table or in this room can say it's going to work instead of going in. Beyond a reasonable doubt. But now if you pick a number, your $700,000 over here, chances are somebody can make it work. That's what I said earlier, just in a different way. But it's up to you guys. I lied. It's up to you what you want to do.
I'm okay with whatever you decide. So
the money is there in general fund for, I mean, like $3,500. I mean, $5,000 of money's there.
I don't know what these guys are thinking about. They're thinking about we spent a lot of money we haven't documented where it's coming from. Yeah. And we've got a lot of money to spend.
That's absolutely right. We got to outweigh which is the best, to know the information or to not know the information.
We got a motion on the table, we got a second. All in favor? We got two ayes, we got three ayes. All opposed? We got one opposed and one undecided.
Being no, but I mean, my deal is.
Wait a minute, we're not.
We've already done it.
I don't think we've done it, I'm sorry.
My deal was if we were going to spend the money, you just pay half of it and have one. You guys did whatever, but let it make sure where she either has it or don't. So, and if they can't go that higher, you guys willing to go higher? If the case is willing to go higher, we should have done it up front.
Can we do away with the boat? Do it again?
Well, if anybody in the rules of Roberts requires the person who voted in the affirmative or the winning vote motions the party to reconsider the vote. This is okay. They voted yes.
Who makes the motion?
Or you could just have a motion to do mathematical difference between $1,500.
Kevin, after conversation, are you interested in changing your motion?
I don't think I'm ready to vote for any more money, no. I don't mind giving $1,500 and let her get started. If she can find the rest of it, get started. But we got a $50,000 building, and I think we've done our part.
It's still here. The motion passed 3-2. So for the $1,500,
right,
but
right.
The other two could make another motion if they wanted to do the difference.
We can have a second motion.
Or we can increase it to $1,500 to another if someone else wants to make that motion.
I'm sorry, I'm butchering this, but I don't know how to do it.
So after all the discussion, what do we want to do?
It's a lot of money, but I do somewhat, after sitting here talking about it for 30 minutes, do understand that the only way I want it done is if, like I said, that we're going to look at that building, we're not looking to try to build a new building. If they want to build a $3.3 million building, then awesome. But if we're going to do a feasibility test to see if this works or what it's going to take to get a store into that building, then yes, I think we ought to go up to the... If she's willing to spend half of it, then I would make a motion to cover the difference between the $1,500 and the $3,450.
I didn't ask, would it be cheaper if they were just looking at one place versus two?
I don't think so.
You don't think so?
My experience is, I think it's the determination of what fits in St. John. And so you're either going to know it fits here and why, or it doesn't fit here and why, but at least if you know what will work there. A smaller shop that only offers anything else. I guess like what I'm saying is, I don't think they can do just one study.
Isn't about a building so much as it is about a grocery business, if that makes sense. I think you're exactly right.
I have a motion, but I don't have a second.
I'll second it.
We've got a motion, we've got a second to raise up to half of the total price. Carolyn Dunn is board about a feasibility study. Any more discussion? Kevin, you got a smirk on your face.
No, I'm just ready to vote.
Okay.
I'm ready.
All in favor? $3,450. Or all opposed? Passes 4-1, Kevin voted no. I apologize.
Thank you. Did you guys have any other questions for me?
But I do still say that we ought to be listening to our task.
Yeah, I think you've done a fine job. I think when you're moving, thank you.
What are we going to talk about?
Well,
I don't think we haven't listened to it.
The reason we haven't is because they just... You guys have signed the contract for the building now, correct? Is it yours?
It's transferred.
It's transferred.
So that just happened. So that's why. So well, we're going to have a meeting and then,
I apologize, but I probably should have told you guys that night.
That's all right. I mean, I assumed it was going to happen, but I didn't know for sure.
What
I would like to do is get with the task force, and we would like to maybe set up what we would like to see the city maybe provide for a grocery store, and then we'll give that to you maybe next meeting, and then you guys can look it over and maybe see what you're willing to do, so that when we do talk to these people again, we can say, you know, hey, here's rent, here's, you know, whatever, so they kind of understand what they're getting into too, if that's all right with everyone.
I'll need to talk to you before then.
Okay, all right, can do. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Her or Marshall, are you going to call that guy and tell him no?
Well, I do believe I already
or that we're doing
left
a feasibility
it that way.
Study.
There he is. I already told him I thought we might be doing a feasibility study. He said he didn't care.
I would imagine he'll call me if I don't call him in the morning. So.
Well, if you, I will be following up with him anyhow. But
well, that's fine.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, is that all on the grocery store task committee? Lisa, you got us a $10 million grant for a grocery store? We need one of them.
Nothing?
I
don't have anything.
Okay, moving on. Police report. Adam, not here. Fire report. Mike, not here. City clerk.
The only thing I have is that next Monday, the planning and commission and the zoning board is going to be having a hearing. At 7:00, if you guys would like to attend.
What night?
It's Monday the 26th at 7:00 here. It's going to be a rezoning and a variance case. Then in October, they will have another one for another rezoning and a special use.
7:00. So you can't do that stuff that far out.
I know,
I'll read it. Okay. I say, if you don't see that, something else, I'll forget it
anyway.
I didn't sign the contract on the skating rink. Interim acting city superintendent.
I got approached the other day by Carl Bear from the school board about some repairs on the what used to be 6th Street on the east side of the Industrial Arts Building. He wanted to know if the city could do anything about that. My understanding is that when the building was built, the properties reverted back to the property owners. That street was closed. We have from time to time done some work up there, but it has gotten to a state of disrepair that it's going to be very expensive. I called Phil Messer, had Phil come down, we looked it over. The city itself does not have the material to repair. We don't have any way to shoot oil. We'd have to do that through the county or any other ideas that the council might have or how much money we wanted to spend, because it seems they have no money in the budget for that. But he was concerned that, you know, come basketball season, they have a lot of traffic in and out of there, and it is very rough. But Phil and I, like I said, we looked at it. I took Reuben up there this morning. Reuben and I looked at it again. And we felt like the only way that we could ever really straighten it out would be to either rent a small milling machine or some way to grind that asphalt completely up and either lay it back down to rock or something like that. It's a poor drainage deal. They wanted us to go clear in past the fence and repair some stuff up towards the back of the building where the concrete stops. It holds a lot of water. It's just a mess. And we felt like that there would be several thousand dollars invested in trying to repair it. Plus the fact that, like I say, we don't have the material to do it at this point in time. By the time we get done repairing what we cut back for this dip that we poured yesterday, we don't have enough to put in on it to do anything. Now we can put some rock on there. He didn't act like they wanted to invest any money per se to help do it, like maybe that we should do it out of our pocket. But I know that in the past when we've done things up there, there has been a charge. We swept the parking lot earlier and charged for that last spring, I think it was. We've done some other things. We have patched a few holes here and there, but it's gotten to the point of disrepair, and if you put very much material in it, the water's going to go back in that old mill shop. So it's going to take some time and some probably, well, depending on what you do, it's going to take some material removal before it can be repaired right. Probably could get into several thousand dollars. So
you did say it reverted back to the landowner.
That's the way I understood it. It reverted back, and that's what Alvin Roadarmel told me too, was that it reverted back to the landowners at the time they built it. The Industrial Arts Building, which has been 30 plus years. So but we have on occasion gone there and repaired a few holes, but it's in pretty rough shape. They didn't have the budget for any kind of repair like that, I guess. It's not really a very good time of year for us to try and do that after the material's already gone. I mean, if we had known about it in the spring, we might have been able to make some kind of concession to help out material-wise. But Philip and that, like, he was very interested from the county standpoint. We have no way to oil it. If we put asphalt back in, we don't have any way to shoot oil. So to tack it back down without removing some material, either going to a hot mix or, I mean, there's several ways we can do it, but or ripping it clear out and putting it back to millings where it can be drug.
Council, I'll put that in your lap.
I'd kind of like to see a dollar figure before you spend
it. Yeah, well, I was going to say it's not one of those, but I think it's our total deal anyway.
Well, that's,
I'm not opposed to helping out as far as the city goes. Of whatever, but I mean, I guess my deal would be to come up with a dollar amount, the best solution.
Okay.
and then come back, and then we can look at it and decide what to do.
I had called Cat about a small skid loader mount planer that we could go in there. It would take a little time, but it would be way less expensive than having somebody come in. Of course, there's no room for anything very big in there anyway, and I haven't got the figures back on that yet, so let me put some stuff together and I'll talk to Phil.
Well, something like that we can honestly use for trying to get our gutters and stuff back too.
And he told me the other day, I visited with Kyle a couple different times, and he said that they have, and like I say, I don't have any figures yet, and I was hoping to have them before spring, but the Caterpillar has a lease program, a very good government type lease program. So I told him at the time, of course that was before Carl had talked to me, I talked to him about some stuff on First Street, trying to straighten it up after the sidewalk and that. And I said, just take your time and get me, you know, a firm price of who foots the bill on the teeth, that type of stuff, you know. And so I think probably in the next few weeks I'll probably see something. But in the meantime, I'll have him give me a rough figure and I'll talk to Phil again and see.
Well, I'm not saying it's something we want to do this year, but up with a dollar amount,
right,
and then we can
right.
look and maybe we exactly. can both put it into our budget.
Sure, sure.
Exactly. That's what we're willing to do.
Yeah.
That's
going to take quite a little bit. You know, it's not only just that street, it goes clear up behind, clear to the south into the industrial arts building. I mean, there's grass growing up. Of course, at one time they poured a concrete kind of a flume or a gutter in there to try and drain that. Of course, the water, it can't get out of there, and then when it goes north, it can't get out of there, and you run into the building deal and trying to get it across the crack. I mean, it's quite a project. So I'll put some numbers together. We'll give you some ideas and see how you feel about how school works. So.
Is that a piece of equipment that is on the attachment on the front? It's a hydraulic driven?
Yeah, it's a high-flow hydraulic driven. Yeah. You can get them from 18 inches wide up to about 48 inches, depending on the size of the machine that you use.
It's 48 inches wide you can get?
You can get them bigger than that if you don't put them on a high loader.
You got a high loader.
Yeah. But I don't know whether it flows enough fluid. That will be the deal, is how many gallons per minute it takes to run. They also make them separate where they're mounted on there and they're engine driven off their own engine. So there are a lot of options. I don't know what's available. I know the smaller ones are available around here, and the reason I know that is because when I talked to him the other day, he has several cities already signing up for short-term rental on these machines in the spring to do the same kind of thing of what we need to do down along the gutter, and in there they'll rent it for a week or 2 weeks at a time, you know. So an 18-inch machine is about standard on about a 65 horse skid loader, and it will plane clear up to 6 inches deep. Those are carbide tips that go on that grinder, and I think they're $5 or $6 a piece to repair them. That's where we're at, trying to figure out who puts the bill on, whether they come out new, replace them, how that, you know, some of that stuff. So anyway, I'll get the figures to you as soon as I can.
That's some information.
I think it's a deal that, you know, if the council wanted to do something like it in the spring, and we can do so many, say, you know, depending on the material, and so many feet a year, then we could come out and we could solve our drainage problems and get back down the gutter by taking out 6 or 8 feet on the side, laying it back in and see when over get the ground back in the street, get it down the gutter where it's maintainable. If we can always spend it and do 600 feet a year, then, you know, we'll catch up. It just takes some time. So anyway, I'll get you the numbers and try and have those ready for next week. That's all I have, only that we got the cement poured. They pulled the forms off this afternoon. We're going to pack all that back in starting in the morning, and we'll be ready to open the street by Friday. So looks really good, really good. Should help drain that. I don't know how much faster it'll run, but depending on whether it rains an inch and a half or it rains 20 inches. But it is, it looks really good. It's back down. We cut it back another 3 feet off of what the concrete apron was because of the humps in the street and stuff to kind of get it back where the transition is smoother. So I did on my own let him put a little stronger concrete in there. It cost us about $300 more, but it sets it quite a bit harder. And so we can open it sooner. We don't have to leave in 7 weeks or so. So anyway, by Friday we should have it open and ready to go. That's all I've got.
Okay, more questions?
Yeah, Jeff, last year we spoke about over that power pole right next to the school.
We're kind of on a debate on that deal, Mark, and the thing is that Kevin and I and Josh have talked amongst between us, not necessarily all together, but between us, the school would like to. We took down a whole bunch of old steel poles around the square years ago. We haven't stacked in the pole yard. We don't have really enough to do anything, but they're too nice to sit and scrap. And they've kind of made the deal that they may want to put maybe two, maybe three along the front of the school. So I've held up setting that pole out there yet to see what they're... Kevin put some conduit underneath the concrete when they re-poured the concrete in front of the north door. So we're kind of waiting to see what they want to do.
Okay.
And then we'll know from there. They kind of want to clean it up. I offered to give them the poles. I said, you know, for scrap price, they're not worth anything anyway. And they're a nice steel arm pole, and they can paint them. And so,
okay.
Anyway, we'll have, I think we'll have a better outcome with a pole in the morning. So.
Oh, that sounds good. All right, great. Thank you.
Okay. That's all.
One more question. Does anyone know what happened to the two tenths that came
out? What?
It's gone.
We've mowed it down.
Nelson didn't go in and decide if something was salvageable or not. So
there wasn't anything to speak of.
He didn't know. He wouldn't.
I asked
if he would, and he said no. So
I went by when it was about half down, and I saw very little.
It's been
mowed. It's cleaned up well.
I know the neighbor to the east sat there and watched the whole thing pretty much. And
he was there when I come by.
So it wasn't full of. It wasn't a house full of valuable antiques.
No, it was excavator material.
Okay, anything else, John?
Yes, I sent out or Madonna sent out a letter regarding. And we don't necessarily have to go into the land bank to talk about this, but regarding some properties that may or may not, depending on what happens between now and beginning of next year, end up in a tax sale. And Carolyn can speak a little bit about some grant opportunities that are coming up that maybe could utilize some of those properties. And I don't know, the council had a chance to read my letter, whether any of those properties. Your interest as far as acquisition by the land bank. I kind of outlined two methods to acquire those properties. What's the deadline for the grant?
I have to have a grant completely written and submitted by October 15th. Okay. Coming right up.
But we can do like a letter of intent.
I'm going to see if that would work. What makes a grant compete well is if you show your readiness to proceed. So not just saying, oh, we'd like to build houses, but here's the land we're going to build houses on. We've got, you know, possession of it and ready. So should I give some background on the grant?
Yeah, I didn't really go.
Is that helpful? I don't want to derail what we're talking about. But one of the things that, the county has applied for moderate income housing program funding in the past, and that was what paid for half of the duplex that was constructed in Stafford, and it's been a good way for us to, I don't know, incent some housing construction. What the county has agreed and economic development agreed to submit a new application for is also moderate income housing program, but all, kind of mirroring a strategy that's been used in the towns of Lyons and Great Bend, where you're trying to incent private investment along, because looking at the house that was built in both Maxville and Stafford, economic development financed 100% of that. So we can try we think we can get more construction done if we try to incent some private investment along with that. What they've done in Lyons and in Great Bend is they offer a $25,000 subsidy to those who are willing to finance the construction of a house. They get that $25,000 toward the down payment of it. It kind of plays into part of what's hard to accomplish in towns where new housing hasn't been built for a long time is the banks don't find comparables. They won't finance the full construction cost because there isn't other comparables in the market. But if you bring down the cost of what has to be financed, that's part of the puzzle of sometimes getting things to work. So the grant money coming from from Kansas Housing Resources Corp would provide that $25,000 down payment. And part of the way that they've set it up in other cases is that the family or the individual or whatever that's buying the house has to agree to live there for 5 years, otherwise they end up paying it back in a prorated sense. So if we're doing this, we've got property in Stafford who would like to have some housing in St. John. We need to identify where we can do that. Looking again to what we did before, we used infill lots. We bought them very, very inexpensively at a tax sale. We bought, for example, Maxville for $10 at a tax sale. That would be a great option, and we were hoping that the tax sale would happen by now, but Joe Shepak hasn't gotten it scheduled yet, and at this point we're looking probably at December. Part of the advantage of using infill lots is that we can get them pretty cheap, but for the purposes of the grant application, they'll look at the value that the street and water and sewer infrastructure is. So if they were, you know, for example, in this program, they're financing in some other towns the construction of that city infrastructure. That is their grant. You know, they're building a new street with new sewer. And it basically becomes a cost of $60,000 for a housing lot. That's what a new developer would probably incur in those kind of development costs. So what we've said in our application, and the Kansas Housing Resources Corp has gone along with it, is that the value of these lots is $60,000. We're kind of showing a local match of that value, even though we all know you couldn't sell them at the market rate at that price. We aren't investing that much, but there's a development value of $60,000 per lot. So it's been a good way for us to kind of, show some local support for this without a lot of expenditure. Thing is, the tax sale has occurred. We don't have those properties in possession, but talking with John, there's, you know, with the land bank in place, that would be, in a sense, economic development functioned as a land bank in previous cases, but you, as a land bank, probably have a way to acquire them prior to that tax sale occurring at a similarly low price, if that individual agrees to sell it for whatever that price is, a couple hundred dollars or something, as opposed to waiting to go to the tax sale. Is that fair?
Yeah, I mean, the land bank had, if you want to call it that, the statutory mechanism that put the land bank, that allowed you guys to create the land bank, has not really been through, has not been around long enough for there to be any kind of court interpretation of what the intent was behind the act. As an example, one reading of the act could be, as I outlined in the letter, that when a property comes into the land bank, any ad valorem property tax liens on that property are gone. The other way to read that statute is that it sits in the land bank or comes in the land bank and then does not get taxed from that point in the future. If somebody owes a couple $1,000s in bag ad valorem property tax, they're not going to get anything to sell that property, but they're going to lose that property at a tax sale. There may be all the incentive in the world to take a couple hundred dollars and deed that property to land. And it could be a quick, easy way to accumulate property in the land bank that could be used for something like this. Now, one of the things that I would probably need to do is visit with the treasurer and see how they would treat the acquisition of the property by the land bank in that kind of scenario. It's kind of a no harm, no foul. If they say, you know, it's our belief that once it hits the land bank, taxes currently owed on that property are wiped out, then, you know, we've got the answer for the purposes of these transactions. But there's no Board of Tax Appeals or Board of Tax Appeals decisions on that issue.
No, half of the properties are no longer on the
city. And that's one of the other problems about paying the bill.
Right. And for the purposes of this, I feel like, you know, if we got four new houses built in Stafford County through this grant program, that'd be a success. We're not going to build So if we had a couple of them in St. John, that'd be a good place to start.
The other deal is I would rather recommend you guys go by and talk to that official and look at the other one.
We talked about that property what, 3 years ago, 2 years ago?
Yep. Yep. They've done an immaculate job on refurbishing it.
Anybody have any comment on other parents' special order?
Yes, until I have to deal with people that do anything anymore.
Well, if it goes to the tax sale, then unless the county abates its share of property taxes, the city can claim the property that came down state in order. You literally, right before the tax sale, the city reports that we're going to pay the taxes and claim the property. And it doesn't go to the tax sale anyway. And sometimes the county will abate that and say, okay, I don't know. I don't think the county can abate all of the taxes, you know, some of them will apply to school district, obviously. But that's one way, or again, we can work with the treasurer to figure out how they would interpret that statute. It's my personal opinion that it only applies going forward. My partner, who's done municipal and county government work for decades before I was born, believes it's going the other way. So there's a little disagreement on some of the section.
Would a way to approach this, knowing that, you know, to work with a grant application that's due in about a month, would a way to approach it be that if we can find agreement with the treasurer's office on how to treat this, and we approach some of those on the list that have not redeemed, I mean, that have not paid their taxes, would the city be willing to dedicate, I don't know, a certain budget amount toward the acquisition of one or two lots?
And I'll add that you're not, I mean, if you did that, that could be part of the letter of intent that you intend to, but it doesn't necessarily mean you purchase. I mean, it would have to come back to you guys, such as we'd probably have to go into executive session, but if I talk to the landowner and they're going to sell for a certain price, then so I can bring it to them.
Sure. I mean, there's no money budgeted in the land bank line item. It all comes out of the general fund.
But the bridge had yard maintenance of 10?
It may have had 10 last year, but there was no budget. There wasn't any budget for 2016.
Does any of that grant consider tear down?
No.
All those properties are available.
They all have houses on, and I think
one of them is a really big house.
Two, I don't think
three
one
still
one
have
one.
People living
there.
Oh, okay. Not a house.
The
church is still on the list.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think two of them still have residents still in them.
Yeah.
If not,
but one of them. No, there's only.
I don't know. I don't know if someone's in the house. So then one still has a resident still in them.
Carol, can you share the properties that you were thinking about?
I'd have to look at the list.
Well,
I'm not particularly picky as long as it.
I highlighted it. This is the publication in Wednesday's paper of what's going to be in the tax sale. And so I highlighted the ones that
are
essential.
Does it have legal or only legal?
It has legal, and I wrote the street next to it because I looked up the legal. And then I had Nita come in.
204 North Main.
204 North Main is Ponchos.
Yeah, this one, the church.
Really
house.
204 North Main, I think we could do a lot of, I think we could do some very interesting things, and I think there's some grants that I can definitely work with renovating it, but it's not residence. It's a pearl.
We could, Marshall and I figured
it
out.
Got it. I can't picture stuff.
Well, that's what she says.
That's what I'm thinking. This next, okay, so looking at the idea of it's near the school, the kinds of things that might make a new house marketable, I would say that that's something we could work with.
Definitely.
That would be something I think that could have nice appeal as far as like. Same with 808 North Main. And the other two, well, okay, so there's only four left on here. So those are the two, if we were looking at residential lots, 204 North Main, it's not necessarily for this particular grant project, but I think we could do a lot of work.
So is the economic development going to take on all expense other than the city buying the property or what? Or donating the property?
Well, if under this grant program, the development cost would be an individual. So it's not the city, if that's your question.
Do what?
So it'd be an individual. You'd be working with an individual buying the house with a $25,000 subsidy that's coming from the Kansas Housing Resources Corp. But I think the fundamental part of your question is, does the city have to pay part of the cost of developing the property?
Yes. And it's no?
Right.
So the only money that the city would be at would be the cost of the grant.
Right.
Or the land bank.
Right.
Whatever.
So now that property's out. It's pretty good day.
Lisa, have you run across any kind of grants about ventilation?
And there's one coming out maybe in February, but it may not come back again. So there's nothing current that
you
I know
might
of.
The back of your mind.
I've been looking. Yeah. I'm at that church now. Yeah.
I don't want to buy the church on that list.
No.
I don't know what to
think about it.
It's got to go.
It's got to go, but not at the expense of $100,000 or whatever to have it tore down.
I'm not necessarily opposed to purchasing the property and, or the land bank doing that and going through that if that's all that stands out.
Well, I don't mind purchasing it. I don't think they're probably either wanting to go for that.
Or the donate or whatever, but I just didn't want to get in a deal with getting the grant and then all of a sudden it's 75, 25 grand or something like that.
Right.
And then we're sitting there trying to cough up money. I don't want to get back into that.
Okay, moving on. Do we need to go to the land bank?
Well, my suggestion, because there's no money in the land bank, that if the council wants to, and I'm not asking to spend money, wants to give me permission to visit with the landowners and negotiate with the landowners, I think the council can say we're going to fund land bank up to this amount of money, and if we use it, we don't use it, because I would still have to come back to you as well. I guess there's no purpose in going to land bank, because land bank doesn't have any money to spend, so you have to put it in the land bank before we went in the land bank.
Yeah, I thought it would leave me too.
I'm trying to all that too.
But that's where the other purchase that you guys made last week came out of, too. Out of that line of the $40,000 to $50,000 for that area.
Move it on.
So do you guys want him to contact the property owners?
I guess it doesn't hurt to contact them and see what they want.
I guess I'll find out whether we got to pay the taxes on it or not.
Well,
that would be the first step, because if we got to pay the back taxes on it, we might as well wait to sell and try to buy it tax-free.
But the grant opportunity will be gone, just so that we're clear on that. Grant opportunity will have passed by the time the tax sale comes.
We'll see if we got to pay the taxes first.
I mean, I wouldn't have a problem spending designating $400 or $500 for the two properties right now. Depending on the taxes on.
If I visit with the county counselor and my interpretation is correct, I'm going to stop. Okay? Because then you're talking about $2,000, $3,000, $4,000 in taxes. If my interpretation is wrong, my partner's interpretation is right, then I would take the next step and contact the land office. I guess that's kind of what I'm seeking permission for now. Instead of me reporting back in 2 weeks, if the treasurer says, yeah, we agree that it's taxes, so free of any tax on it, I'll go ahead and take that next step and counsel the council without going back to report.
Of contacting them, maybe?
Of reaching out to the land office. As far as the grant, if you're wanting to take advantage of the grant this year, I think what Carolyn's saying is she would like not necessarily monitor commitment in the fact that you're agreeing to purchase properties for X number of dollars, but that you're willing to budget it if it gets used, if it's used, if it doesn't. So the process would be, if I talk to the treasurer gives me the clear, then I talk to the landowner, and the landowner says, yeah, we'll do it for X number of dollars, then I would come back to council and next meeting or after that and say, this landowner has made an offer to sell to the land bank their building for X number of dollars, you guys would then approve it.
I don't have a problem.
I think
that'd be fun.
We need a budgetary commitment to say that we're going to spend it.
What I did in the last one is I showed copies of the deeds. I mean, it was absolutely clear cut that we had the ability to build on the land we designated. I mean, so I don't know. It's probably stretching it, but I feel like we can probably work with some type of letter from our city's attorney saying our town is in the process of acquiring these properties or something, you know. But what I need to show in a grant application is that if we were funded, we could actually start building, you know. And the thing is, you know, there's even though that grant application is due in October, it's probably going to be after the beginning of the year before we know whether we were approved or not. But still, the deadline remains that the application's due October 15th.
Our next date is October 4th.
Council, we need some direction.
And if I had visited with the landowners by the 4th, the council approves on the 4th, would we be sufficiently ready to plug in that stuff?
I think so.
Okay.
So see what you can find out.
Yeah, there you go.
Need a motion?
No, I've got that. My last thing is going to come out of left field. And I know you guys are interviewing superintendents, and we're going to talk again today. And Donna's leaving in a couple months.
Year.
Whenever.
Unless
they want to. The last time we went through this round of things, Julianne asked me to look into whether St. John should consider some kind of city manager, city administrator position. And I'm just bringing it up again, whether you guys would be interested in, I guess, restructuring almost. You'd be restructuring the government if you take the building, the city of St. John, but going to the city manager, city administrator, type form of government where you have somebody who's hired to run city mayor becomes basically at that point, depending on what you guys decide to do. Right now, the structure is the mayor hires, the mayor directs, consent of council. For larger cities, that can be kind of difficult. I've not done any kind of research, so I don't have any examples to show you, but I would say that you're probably one of the very few cities of this size, this area, that doesn't use that type of that structure of government. Then Julianne brought it up at one meeting, and there was some little discussion about it. I don't know if that's something you guys would consider, or provide examples, or what. I'm not saying obviously going off the ballot, but, you know, as an attorney that looks at things from far away and doesn't live here.
I'll be happy to walk out that door.
Well, I'm saying we went through the issues of having to replace the mayor and replace the council
member.
And
here's
that. You know, I like that kind of institution almost, I guess. Just throwing it out there for consideration.
No. You would still have to be here.
No, I would.
We could double your salary. We could double your salary right now.
Yeah, double my
salary. Yeah. I think it's going fair.
What do you think? Discussion that, or what are you doing?
I just think it's another giant salary. We've got someone sitting here behind the desk.
Paying one person to do two people's jobs. We've had two previously.
How far back?
Dan Corbin's one of them. Tom Sullivan. So you didn't have a city clerk and a city superintendent. You said, that's what we did both of them. Took care of the financing and plus also, you know, we had superintendents like the water, like that, and they met with the industry. So that's the way
it works. Yeah, if you get rid of the clerk's position, and that's the superintendent, that's
the way he handled the finances and the budget and all that stuff. You know, met with the superintendents of the different departments, but other than that, when you ran, you start thinking, well, it works both ways.
So it's like a $75,000 deal.
Yeah, I don't.
60, I mean, plus whatever.
Yeah. I think the whole of the contract from the last one that we were involved in, the hire, was with Greensburg, and I can't remember what they're paying. I mean, it was an experience one, you're right, it's going to cost. Not six figures, but they're close to six figures. In the bigger cities, they make in excess of six figures. But, you know, sometimes they, depending on their background, sometimes that, depending on education, they can find savings in areas that, I mean, their job is to please you, essentially. They work at the will of the council. A lot of those forms of government, they become commissioners. It's just something. Yeah, I thought there was a time to do it, just a good time. Council?
That have the city administrator, but you still have the city clerk. Because there's no way that city administrator can do everything that the city superintendent can do and the city clerk, unless they want to work like 12 hours a day.
Right.
I just don't see it.
I'd say let's just leave it alone.
I'm fine with that.
That's going to be a special person. We'll figure out what
talk about old business.
Have they ever got back with us?
Actually, yeah. Do you have any?
Yeah. I talked with the owner of the property most recently today, and he's willing to basically pay half, $15,000. So, you know, what I have is a phone conversation with them. So I don't know if the attorney has any recommendations on, do we just like write a letter of some sort, kind of verifying our agreement so that when the cost is incurred that he can actually be invoiced for it.
Letter of intent. I mean, I don't remember exactly what was their decision about how much the council was going to spend on fencing.
I think we were waiting to hear back from.
Yeah, we were waiting to hear back from Dollar
General. So I provided him the estimate that LaDonna got from Mansell Construction. And roughly, it boils down to $10,000 worth of concrete and $20,000 worth of fence. And so that's where he said, well, I'll be willing to pay up to $15,000. So it's, for the record, it's not Dollar General Corporation. It is Larry Magnavitz, who has a firm that invests in property. They own a lot of post office buildings as well as Dollar General buildings around the country. And they own this property, so he kind of came to the conclusion that if it's good for the store there, that's good for keeping a tenant there over time. And for the record, he said that we're the only one that's ever asked him for something like this. And I said, well, because it took a whale of work to figure out who you are. Nobody else knows how to contact. But,
anyway. So is that something the council is thinking about pursuing, or you can't leave the man, if you're willing to spend $15,000, you can't leave him hanging around?
We kind of talked about the fence before. Can we get a cheaper fence? I mean, what kind of fence was that?
I don't know.
We
might know.
I think it
was a vinyl fence, wasn't it?
Yeah, that's
the
two options.
The other thing is, there's going to need to be a survey so that legals can be drafted. And putting a sidewalk in there is probably going to hold on. So that, I don't know how much that's going to cost.
Creates a problem.
We had a survey done of the property here in town. The different size of property said that it was $400 for this.
A tall wood fence is $10,500, and a 6-foot reinforced vinyl fence is $17,923.
City going to maintain these things?
No.
So there needs to be an understanding between the city and the land.
My understanding was that Axons were willing to donate the land for the fence.
Well, I mean, it needs, unless the city wants to maintain it.
Well, that's what.
I don't know what we're talking about here, but there needs to be some kind of survey done. It's either going to be an easement or it's going to be.
Easement back there, where's that play in? Do you know, Jeff?
I think it's 16 feet wide.
I remember some tricky stuff
there. But it's part of it is the pole line is not straight due to the fact of the corner landowner would not give the city an easement at that time. And so the pole line jogs the way it is. It's really, it's not even a very good access for our trucks. If it ever got muddy, we'd be in and out with a dozer. I mean, it's all low. I don't know. I mean, it's, you know, we have to be able to get into that pole line, and we can't very well do it off of the private property, off of the landowners' parking lot, that stuff, you know. We destroy a parking lot with bucket trucks like buying that too. So I don't really know. I guess, like John, maybe we need to know what the survey looks like on it first. I know that right at about the end of where that sidewalk is now, or somewhere close, is the edge of that property. Going to the north. Because I remember when we built that house at the corner of that parking lot at Methodist Church is really on accident property. When that parking lot was torn.
Yeah, I think
it cuts through there. It cuts kind of funny, but it's
one thing was up.
But that property goes quite a ways back, farther west, I think, than the Methodist Church had realized when they built that building.
Kevin, when we put that sewer line in there for Dollar General, what do we run into?
I don't remember.
There was something to do with the easement.
Well, their private sewer runs on our easement. Because the main stops on First Street.
Yeah, the extension from the Methodist Church on down is private.
Yes, it is.
And then they got private deals from Jeff Dodson to go
across. Yes.
I think that's something you better do some attorney work on.
I think there's some paperwork involved on that. I'm pretty sure there is.
I think John said the first step was the surveys.
Well, I can work with the city staff to figure out where we go. I guess as far as Dollar General, their commitment good for a while.
Oh, I think so. We're the ones that are pushing it.
Gift that property to Dollar General, I could call it.
I am out of pocket, and I will be here for council meeting, but that first week in October, I am in a 5-day trial, so I'm not going to be able to come up here and get these or anything until probably that second week. Plus, that's another time.
Oh, yeah, the east end is marked, and that east end. Imagine we're looking at investing $1,200 or $1,500 to have it measured. It cost me $800 to have it done from the rest home going back west, and then 600 or 700 feet for that pole line in there, so I bet you're looking at $1,200 to get shopped. If it has to be legal, you kind of have to. That's the only way you can do it. It has to be certified. It's not a job, I know it does.
I don't know, I remember something about the.
Yeah, it's messed up.
We got some time. Let's think about it. Okay.
Do you want me to look at the record that I got on and see what kind of landowners we're talking about and the easements? If I'm up here sometime.
It's not up to me. The west side of it would be one end. The east side of it is going to be two.
The west side would be two. The Axmans and Methodist Church both.
No. The Axmans have a big old wide
driveway through there. Yeah, but the edge of that too, the west edge, well, no, because it goes, you're right. Yeah, it would just be Axmans because it comes, that piece only, comes down in there.
Actually, it's only one and one. It's not like we got to worry about Dollar General.
No, because once you get up there, while you're
so all you got to worry about is the one landowner on each side. And we know the one's highly flexible. So
the one that's going to give you the problem is the one that's got to sign for sale.
Well, I know. Some of them.
That's the pressure gauge. Yeah.
Sitting there, man, think up there, think about it.
So do you want him to go look at the deeds and report back? Do you want him not to do anything and you guys think about it and then we'll bring it up again on the 4th?
Let's think about it.
Don't do anything. Okay, new business. Anything to report?
I guess I had something I should have told you. We had a fire plug hit the other night out of the 5th and Santa Fe, and the parts will be paid for off of a fine that the guy that confessed to hitting me. So we'll have a bill coming in for some parts, but as soon as we get the price on it, it will be reimbursed. So.
Plus
I guess work that any way you can. I don't know how much we'll get out of it.
I asked for everything. I asked
Thankfully, it's a breakaway dry plug, so you know we had an hour's overtime of picking it up and hauling it in, tearing it down, and plus the parts and putting it back together.
I think we ought to pay for every expense involved.
We can do that. It's not a problem. Parts are here, so as soon as we get loose, we'll do that. We're going to put it
up. Another double laser stand on otherwise.
I think it was witness too. That was the thing. Oh, yeah, it was kind of hard to get out of it. Because there was a gal taking the trash out at the time it happened. So,
let him cover the whole bill.
We'll see what we can do. We can do that.
Okay, then. That need to go on to the new business? Or any discussion? Do we need executive sessions?
Yes. Got an executive session about the city superintendent.
Wait,
I'm not down there yet.
15, 10.
Well, let's not do 5, because 30, last time we got to come back.
25,
12. Yeah, Tony, are you guys going to be around for a while?
Yeah, I will be.
Okay, we'll talk to you real quick.
You want 10 minutes? You want 15 minutes? So we're going to reconvene.
8:57.
With an option to bring Jeff back in.
I do have a question, and I don't care if you can answer it, if anybody can, and I don't have the answers. How and what is a bond issue consistent?
Well, it just kind of depends on what you want to issue for.
Okay.
And there's very specific.
What if we decide that we need to have a bond for a grocery store? Somebody give me some information.
The only information I can provide you is that there is an attorney in Wichita that does own the con.
Okay.
I mean, that's about the extent.
And I would think it would have to go. You would have to go back to the city, and the city would have to vote on it. You couldn't just say, "Hey, we're going to do this bond." You would have to do an election. The city would have to vote.
So the county have to on the possible
general. They would have to vote for it.
So it has to go to
if for some election. Reason, yep. Because if for some reason the city couldn't maintain the bond or like pay it back, it would be paid back by the citizens with their mill levy.
Just like the sales tax, you guys would have to vote to put it on the ballot by adopting the ordinance or resolution. And if approved, then you have to vote again by ordinance.
I mean,
it's not a quick process, but there needs to be somebody who's got that. Somebody's got to sell the bonds. Usually you work with the person that's going to sell the bonds because they're the ones that are going to know when the best time is to sell the bonds, so that you're getting a little rate. You know, how much you guys can, I mean, probably the feasibility study to figure out how much bond you want to do, or how much bonds you want to sell. As far as whether you have to afford issue bonds, and that's something I don't know.
In the past, we've worked with a company by the name of Ransom Capital, which is
probably the same.
Whether it was a general obligation bond, the city is the whole paid.
And
think we track a, like a street where a certain percentage went to the landowners and a certain percentage.
They get paid from the bond, issue a bond, their fees are included in that, and so they keep track of that when it's a good time to refinance bonds, because it's going to save the city money, they're still getting paid.
There's forms of forgiveness depending on how the bonds come back, what the interest rate does. There's a lot of things that go into it. We have had rebates on some. I know we did on that engine, on that OP in the early 90s. It came up and we got a pretty good rebate back by making a payment at a different time when the interest rate went down. And usually what they do is they go and they sell them out to private individuals or investment companies. So a lot of different places. I know some people here in town that bought bonds when that engine was put in that had the money to invest in. The rate was already fixed. They knew what their returns would be. They bought $30,000, $40,000, $50,000 worth because they make better interest making than what the bank did and stuff like that. Private individuals has access to buy those just like the
It seems to be the right time. The county and Pratt just refinanced the bonds for the hospital. That's the second time they've done it. I think they said $1 million or $15 million bond.
I'm just digging for some information, fellas. I'd entertain a motion.
So moved.
Second favor. Let's get out of here.